I'd like to welcome you to this afternoon's discussion, Visualising a Nation. First, I'd like to acknowledge the Gadigal of the Eora Nation, the traditional custodians of this land, and pay my respects to the elders both past and present. So we're joined today by a diverse panel of leading thinkers and practitioners who will discuss the role of Max Dupain Sunbaker, what it represents, and if it continues to reflect an Australian ideology of self. Our chair today is Helen Vatsikopoulos. Helen is a Walkley award-winning journalist who has worked for both the ABC and SBS over a 30-year career specialising in international reporting. She's currently a lecturer in journalism at UTS, and we're very privileged to have her with us today. Stephen Gilchrist is Associate Lecturer of Indigenous Art at the University of Sydney and currently completing his PhD. Belonging to the Yimatji people of the Ngara language group of northwestern Australia, Stephen has written and taught extensively on Indigenous art from Australia and is one of Australia's most considered and thought-provoking curators. Professor Meaghan Morris is Chair of the Inter-Asia Cultural Studies Society and past Chair of the International Association for Cultural Studies, a Fellow of the Australian Academy of the Humanities, the Hong Kong Academy of the Humanities, and a former ARC Senior Fellow. She was also Founding Chair, Professor of Cultural Studies at Lingnan University in Hong Kong. And our final panellist possibly needs no introduction, William Yang. William, born in North Queensland and moved to Sydney in 1969, and since then has documented Sydney's social life, which included the glamorous celebrity set and the hedonistic subcultural gay community. He works as both a writer and photographer, and a number of his works were included in our Under the Sun exhibition on display upstairs in the Mitchell Galleries. So thank you all for coming. We have also have two upcoming events in relation to our Sean Gladwell exhibition. Dr. Kit Meshamua on Tuesday the 11th from 6 p.m. discussing his publication Double War. So he'll give a talk and a book signing in our project space at 72 Oxford Street. And a hands-on AR workshop with Deluxe Media Arts on Saturday the 29th of April at 10 a.m. with a tour and a how-to on immersing yourself in future technologies. Finally, I'd like to give you a quick reminder that our exhibition Under the Sun closes on the 17th of April. The exhibition itself has been supported by the State Library of New South Wales through partnership, the now-defunct Catalyst, and a group of commissioning partners, including Lisa Paulson, who has kindly joined us today. Please enjoy today's panel.
Hello, my name is Helen Vatsikopoulos. Thank you so much for coming today. I think it's a fascinating talk today. One image that has come to somehow represent the nation. Now, this is the Australian Centre for Photography also sponsoring this. So I just want to quote their inaugural director, Graham Howe. He's quoted in the Australian Financial Review as saying to Max Dupain, I said, Max, this is the one that says Australia. It conveys what it is to be Australian. Sunbaker was a quintessentially Australian photograph.
William, of course, the man in the photograph isn't even Australian. He's British, and it was taken at a time of the White Australia policy. Indigenous Australians didn't have the vote. What did it represent to you when you first saw it, and what has it come to represent since then?
I'm fairly close to an era of photography that Max Dupain was part of, which is like the photojournalist style. And when I first saw it, I can't remember when, but I saw it first of all as a photograph rather than the content, because then there were actually more rigid rules of photography, formal rules, and there was the quality of the print that you'd look at almost before you'd consider the content of it. And I liked it because, well, I liked its architectural values, and I liked the fact that it was a male study. And then it was probably, they were rarer then, and it probably wasn't until later that I started to think about the content of it, but I liked it because it's a sexy image.
And when you think about the content of it, how has your thoughts about it evolved?
Well, I thought that it's held up quite well, actually, for what it is. And I think that sometimes if you don't show a face is really, really what I discover just in my own photography. If you present a back view or don't show a face, it allows more interpretation, more... There are more stories you can tell about it if you don't see the face. So I think that it works on that level.
Well, as you can see behind us, it's been reimagined for a long, long time, and even reimagined by Anza Halker, who is out here in the audience, who I'm sure can say something later. Meaghan, how is it that that photograph has had such broad appeal? It has evolved so many years and been reimagined. What is it about it that has carried it through?
Well, I think I can only answer that by adding something personal also about what it represented to me, because I think, as Stephen has already said, one image never captures a totality. But some images manage to gather together many, many different ways of looking. And I have to admit that I saw Anza Halker's Sunbaker before I saw Max Dupain's image. I saw the Sunbaker in 1989, I think that image was made. And this is around the period of the bicentenary, almost 30 years ago now, but there was a lot of discussion then about the zone of the beach, what does it mean in colonial stories, this is the landing place, you know, the violence, the attraction. 30 years ago, we talked about that endlessly. So for me, Anne's image was very, very important. And then I discovered Dupain's image. And to be honest, what it does for me is recall a very strong feeling of nostalgic memory for my father's generation. My father was actually a lifesaver in 1937 when this image was shot. He was a lifesaver on Coogee Beach. And Martin Jolly has some, you know, lovely comments in his catalogue essay about how in those days lifesavers would like walk around with flags like the Nuremberg rallies. I mean, no doubt they did, but my father would have been horrified by that thought. He was a communist. And the story he told about being a lifesaver was how they would go to Coogee, turn on their backs in the water and catch the rip to Tamarama. And it was a story of something that I think for me is in that image, that sense of just a moment of peace and contemplation in natural elements. But the minute I say a nostalgic memory, then I think about, say, my own childhood growing up in little fibro houses. Working class holidays in the 1950s tended to be in beach towns. And then the next thing I think is about why that way of life is gone. And then I go straight into the world of Desilie Deacon's sand mining and sand grab and the disappearance of a culture where ordinary people, people without very many resources, had access to the sunbaking life without like giant hotels being in the way. So I link in that way to the story of a time in Australia which is much mythologized, which had a lot of problems, a lot of ugly things about it, but also a lot of lovely things. And I think about how that is gone, and the art of this exhibition is drawing our attention to now.
Well, that's interesting. So for you, Destiny Deacon sand mining was something that really resonated with you in this exhibition. Personally, for me, I loved Yoni Skaggs. Wonderful. I hope if you haven't seen it, go and have a look at the exhibition, because this was a beautiful photograph of a working class man an open miner in Andamooka in South Australia, which is where we migrated to when we first came to Australia. And the wife was in the background, and it just reminded me of my first memories of Australia, working parents, working shifts, working 24 hours, being a latchkey kid. So it really resonated with me. And with you, obviously, it was Destiny Deacon. That image of Destiny Deacon's also had some Aboriginalia. Stephen, I want you to continue and tell me what you thought of that and also what really resonated with you in this exhibition.
Yeah, well, I think, you know, both your stories about what works resonated with you is interesting because, you know, sometimes we do search for ourselves in these images. And, you know, in looking at the Sunbaker, I don't think I did see myself represented in the images of Australianness. And, you know, why that is, you know, why Aboriginal people were kind of excluded from these kind of formations of national identity. And so the images that Destiny Deacon is using are these, what appears to be these kind of kitsch Aboriginal kind of sculptures, probably kind of factory made, not made by Aboriginal people. So this generic representation, and you know, the conceit of the image is that they're somehow kind of, you know, being, I don't know, raised from the dead, or kind of they have been buried alive. And so for me, you know, thinking back at the Dupain image, it is about, you know, what lies beneath, you know, what we see is only half the story, and how Aboriginal people have been kind of filtered out of the national consciousness in kind of, you know, sometimes naive ways, but often quite cruelly and kind of intentional ways. And so, you know, actually the Destiny Deacon work was a work that I, you know, thought quite a lot about. And, you know, it is this idea of, you know, land, but it's also this idea of kind of the earth, you know, that, you know, we have a responsibility to the earth. And so, you know, all of these extractive industries that she's kind of critiquing, you know, are very kind of, aren't reciprocal. You know, we need to kind of reimagine our relationship to the earth in ways that are kind of not just consumptive and kind of transactional. And so, you know, it is, you know, about, you know, thinking about our responsibilities to place that I think, you know, goes at the heart of, you know, the Dupain image, but also the Deacon image as well.
Well, you knew a part of this exhibition, so tell us what you were thinking when you were asked to be part of this and reimagine Max Dupain's images, and what else resonated for you in what you have seen in this exhibition?
I'll answer the last question first, which is I responded to Julie Rapp's sculptural exhibition. And she said that she wanted to get beneath the surface, and so she thought of looking up at the Sunbaker, and then she decided to make the image. It's the three-dimensional image, which is slightly interactive. It's in bronze, and people, I guess, are invited to put their head in their arms in the position of the Sunbaker. And when I was there on the opening night, people were doing that. And I just quite like a bit of interaction in an artwork. But getting back to my own stuff, when Claire invited me, I immediately thought of my own collection of beach photographs. And as I said, although my images are 30 years after Max, we were still in this documentary photojournalist mode. So it's not entirely unrecognizable, the rules of engagement that we had then. And I got quite a big collection, and they span 30 or 40 years. And so I wanted to reimagine my collection, really. That's my reimagining of the Sunbaker. And it comes from the very first time that I saw Bondi Beach. I'd seen beaches before, of course, because I come from Queensland. But Bondi just struck me as being well, it was big, and there are all these surfies lined up along the road, looking out to the sea, and that image struck me as very alluring, and I'd never quite seen that before. And so I had an engagement and a romance with the beach, which was because it was in the 70s, and the 70s for me was a time of liberation, and there were lots of movements. There was feminism and there was gay liberation. They were liberation movements. And in fact, my liberation was just being able to photograph what I liked. And somehow, up until now, or up until then, I'd censored myself completely. And I also wanted to hide my gayness. And so it was, you go through a very peculiar mental state where you're kind of disguising what you actually want to look at. And this happens all the time, and it happens in all cultures, I think, especially formal cultures. And so that was my liberation at that time. And I think I wrote about that on one of the pictures. And it progressed through the various decades where I did live at South Bondi at one stage, and I used to go to the beach a lot. It was part of my lifestyle, and I liked the surf carnivals because they were exciting spectacles, and so I photographed them. And then there was another period, a later period, when I had a splash-proof camera. And I found that there was a different engagement when I could take my camera into the sea, and somehow that transformed the way that I related to people, because they just weren't expecting. It was unexpected to have a camera when you were out swimming, and people were disarmed by that, and they were very open to me. And although it's a very small body of work, I really like those photographs. And then later, when I don't take so many photographs of the beach now, I've tampered with the photographs that I already have, and that's kind of like being more contemporary, being more photo media rather than just documenting them. And so I've kind of put my foot in the contemporary door by this process, by first of all writing on them, and then as an extension of that, on one of them I've drawn hopper-sized wave, and so that's just like another level of tampering. And on one I've put gold leaf, so that's how I kind of put together that body of work that you saw.
And there it is, the gold leaf of the photo. I wonder what Max would think 80 years after he took that image that we are sitting here talking about it, and how it's been mythologized and how it's been reinterpreted all these years later. So in 1991, someone did ask him, Helen Ennis asked him for an explanation of the fame of the Sunbaker, and he responded, "I'm a bit worried about it. I think it's taken on too much. It was a simple affair. We were camping down the south coast, and one of my friends leapt out of the surf, slammed down onto the beach to have a sunbake. We made the image, and it's been around, I suppose, as a sort of icon of the Australian way of life," which really takes us to, you know, the very, very first question that we asked, but also about the photograph that once it's out in the public sphere may not be resonating in the way that the artist had originally intended it. And then that brings into question all those issues about co-opting images and taking images and repurposing them. Stephen, I want to ask you to talk about that. What does it mean when that happens? And does it really matter, really? Isn't it the interpretation of the audience that is the magic in the photo? What do you make of that?
Well, I do think that, you know, works of art have, you know, a first life when the artist is making it, and, you know, then it has a second life when it's in the public domain. And sometimes there is an alignment and sometimes there isn't. You know, I think in this particular image, you know, it was taken in the 1930s and then kind of, you know, reimagined in the 1970s. And then, you know, we're talking about now in 2017. And, you know, so much has changed, but also so much stays the same. You know, we only have to think about, you know, the riots in Cronulla, about this idea of, you know, the beach still being, you know, a contested space. And, you know, and then, you know, in our own kind of much more kind of differentiated and complicated understandings of national identity at the moment. But, you know, there still is this question of, you know, what we choose to remember as a nation and who and what we're forced to forget. And, you know, we have these competing kind of policies, well, sometimes they're competing policies about kind of reconciliation and multiculturalism. You know, these are so much part of, you know, national discourse at the moment. You know, but we've been talking about reconciliation for 20 plus years. I mean, is this something that's, you know, something that is just not complete or incompletable? And so, you know, images like these, you know, they circulate in the national consciousness and they circulate, you know, as these binding and lasting images of something that happened in the 1930s. And so, you know, we need to, you know, which is what this exhibition is doing, creating kind of expansionary movement in that image. And, you know, what I think about the image now is that how, you know, Australians are pathologically afraid of the sun, you know, that we're kind of all have vitamin D deficiencies and, you know, we kind of slip, you know. And the only people you see at the beach now sometimes are the English kind of backpackers. You know, so, you know, even that kind of image, and, you know, there's something about the identity of the subject and how he was a lily white Englishman or something like that. You know, so there's this kind of desperation to kind of be brown, you know. And so I kind of like that idea on a kind of literal but also a metaphorical level that, you know, it is about trying to approximate this kind of indigenized understanding of what it means to belong to this place.
And I'd like to add to that that I think most really successful images that are taken up in these very complicated ways, they don't just represent something to the people. They offer a model or a suggestion of how things are or how things ought to be. Sunbaker, you know, if you put it on Instagram now, losing all of the beautiful definition of the water, someone would go, oh, nice guns, you know. So that would be one type of circulation, but...
Guns?
Guns is biceps.
Oh, okay.
You don't work out. I'm just joking there, but, like, there is that sculptural Rodin kind of quality to that image, but it's also a cultural model of how to use the beach. What are you supposed to do on the beach? You're supposed to lie, be meditative, be contemplative. And that's why, for me, out of a really rich exhibition, one of the things I will continue to think about for a long time is this awesome video by Nazim Nazra called Still for 80 Years. For me, the memory of the Cronulla riot, which was very much grew out of conflicts about how to use the beach. You know, what happens with these people playing soccer, kicking sand in your face, like, why are you lying there with your top off while I'm trying to play soccer? This sort of very low level conflict had been going on those beaches for some years. And the absolute magic to me of the video is the way this Dupain singular, very still figure, frozen in this moment of, you know, doing the culturally correct thing on the beach, is replaced by six people of very different faces when we see their faces, all with fantastic hair. And they begin in the stillness position, and then one by one they come up, and this incredible music, the Sufi music, goes on for nearly 20 minutes, I think, and they dance, and they dance with their hair, and they move, and the beautiful, increasingly frenzied movement is combined with a meditative, mesmeric kind of quality, and then at the end each of them goes down and then you think it's over, and then one person looks up and smiles at the camera. I mean, it, to me, this is a really, really major piece.
This is it, we can see it here.
This is a really, really major piece about which just fills me with optimism and happiness about new possibilities for Australia. This is another way to use the beach. But it recognises and is respectful of the Dupain way to use the beach, but it just gives us so much more richness. And I think this type of take-up of an image is just tremendously creative for all our possibilities of thinking about our lives. And William Yang's splash-proof images do that for me too. I mean, they're just fantastic. You can see people's joy and amazement at this kind of madman coming with a camera through the surf, and the way you capture the foam and the spray, all the movement is there in the still image. So it takes us past that frozen sense of how to be good on the beach, and I love it.
So, madman with a camera. As a photographer, does it matter what your intention was? Does it matter to you if the audience, the viewers, get something else from it? And what about when an image is hijacked for something else? Have you thought about those things that... there might be some people who are anti-gay marriage who might find some of your work and use it for negative purposes, or, I mean, what do you think when you take the image in terms of how you want to project it out there?
The process is much more internal for me, and I think it is probably for a lot of photographers. And once it goes out there, it's got its own life, and I don't really try to control it. And you were asking me about, well, times have changed. Like, I'm almost, because my career has spanned 40 years, I can remember what things were like when I first started off, and we were much more precious about our images then. And there was this thing called copyright, and we'd be mortified if someone used them. But now there's been this explosion of images worldwide. First of all, with the digital cameras, and so that everyone has got a photographic collection. And also there's social media, but not only do they have a social a collection of photographs, but they've also got their personal biographies and live stories to go with it. So it's really, it's been an explosion of image. Like, there are more images in the world now than there were 10 years ago. And I personally feel less precious about my images now and don't mind if people plagiarise them. In fact, I feel a little flattered, actually, when people use my images. And I've personally become less precious about them. And it's harder to actually police your images too, I think. I mean, there are obvious, you can recognise them if people are using them for commercial gain, but I think that the the strict copyright is loosened a bit.
As you said, you know, we are just inundated with images and video and media. You know, it's the internet revolution, you know, Instagram, cable television. We just have so much choice. And I'm just wondering, now that we have so much choice, is the media then much more representative of reality and cultural diversity? Stephen, I'll ask you, because we have NITV, the ABC has certainly lifted its game in terms of, you know, programming on Aboriginal issues in terms of normalising. Has that made a difference, do you think? Have we been able to, with all the choices, to dispel the stereotypes?
Yeah, I think there is kind of room for kind of prototypes to exist alongside these stereotypes. And then, you know, I'm happy for a kind of a token to appear on TV, because hopefully the token becomes standardized and, you know. But I see that not happening as much as you would like on kind of mainstream TV, really. You know, on reality TV shows like Australian Idol, which I happen to love, you know, it was multicultural without even trying, you know, because, you know, and I really enjoyed that, you know, seeing, you know, lots of different kinds of people on TV. And you didn't really see that on scripted dramas. I think, you know, now you're seeing a lot more, but it depends on kind of which platform you're kind of dipping your toe into. And so, you know, NITV is fantastic. And, you know, but I... You know, whenever you go to any Aboriginal community, you'll see NITV on the TV. But I wonder how many, you know, Australians are kind of, you know, watching NITV on a kind of daily basis.
Exactly. And for the program makers, does it then let them off? Because they can say, oh, yeah, but we've got NITV over there. Like a lot of people say, the ABC sometimes says, oh, we've got SBS over there for, you know, the ethnics. And I don't think that word exists.
Yeah.
But does that let them off the hook then?
Yeah, I do think so. I mean, I think, you know, there was an Aboriginal character on Neighbours, you know.
Once.
Erinsborough kind of got diverse. And, yeah, but I...
How long lasted?
I'm not sure. I haven't watched Neighbours for a long time. But I think he was also gay, which is kind of, you know...
Okay, tick-tick.
Tick-tick. But yeah, I do think, you know, you see these things happening in the art world as well, you know, that in all our talk about kind of multicultural and all the cultural complexities of that, that, you know, you enter the Aboriginal galleries and then you enter the Australian galleries and then you enter the international galleries. So, you know, we still are kind of reproducing these kind of racially stratified societies that we kind of, I don't know if we're nostalgic for that or if that still exists, I'm not sure.
Well, it's interesting you brought up reality TV because you are absolutely right. If you watch, you know, My Kitchen Rules or the other one, I don't know, but you will see a cross-section of Australian society that you do not see on the programming that is drama or anything else. So that says there's something wrong with the content makers or the people who decide the content, and That's a huge flaw, isn't it?
Yeah, and, you know, something that I also think about with the Dupain image is that idea of kind of bodily freedom, you know, like the historic endangerment of the Aboriginal body, you know, in the 1930s, and also it's a male body, it's not a female body. And so, yeah, who is policing the kind of freedom of movement that we now kind of are encountering?
I just want to take that question further to William. You know, if we talk about, you know, Chinese have been in Australia since the gold rush, but, you know, if when you switch on the TV, do you see any substantial Asian characters that are in positions of power or anything like that? Or is that something that you're conscious of, or it doesn't really matter?
Well, I'm part of a group called Contemporary Asian Australian Performance, and we've been around for over a decade, and I go back further than that in my own personal performance, and we're always pushing to have more Asian faces on television. That's just one of our goals. We do other things. But it has helped. I have noticed more Asian faces on the television, and there are more kind of Asian celebrities around as well. But I want to tell you about an experience. This is a cultural experience that I had, where I went to see Chimerica just a few weeks ago. It's finished now. And I went along really just because I wanted to see Asian actors, because we deal a lot with Asian actors on the main stage. And probably there hasn't really been a big theatre production apart from Miss Saigon, where you could see Asian actors. And so that was exciting. And I was thinking when we were seeing it, because I didn't particularly like either the Western actor, the characters, so it wasn't such an enjoyable experience to play. But I, in some sense, I did enjoy it, just seeing the Asian put actors whom I knew, and so it was just, it's great to see them up there. And I was reminded of a story that classic Casablanca, which was made in the 1940s, it came out and it had a black character in it, the piano player Sam, who sings As Time Goes By. It's one of the pivotal moments of the film. And when they showed that photograph at the time in the black ghettos in America, the audiences would demand to stop the film and replay that scene over again, because they had never seen themselves portrayed on the silver screen before. And so I did actually think of that thing, because I felt that I had actually felt a little bit starved of seeing Asian actors on the big national stage. So yes, it happens, it is happened. It happened, but there's a kind of, I guess, a longing in me, you know, being deprived, and that's what all those liberation movements of the 70s, which I identify with so strongly, did to me.
When you watch an American television program, a drama or a police drama, you can see America represented. It's not the case, you know, the chief of police is African-American, and then there's, you know, an Asian detective, and it's so normal. We don't go, oh, look, that person is risen up to that position, wow. But if we saw that in Australia, we might be... oh, that's interesting. If I saw something on Australian television, I'd go, oh, that's interesting. They've obviously decided to... Meaghan, I want to bring you in here, because I know you've been away a lot, but we have had some programming that has made us go, oh, Redfern Now, that's interesting. There's the other one, Here Come the Habibis. So it's, a Lebanese family in your street. Isn't that interesting? And it's not even in punch bowls. So what do you think about that? You know, when we do have these, we go, oh, wow, isn't that interesting? It's not something that we just go as another television program.
Well, obviously, it's really important that that's happening, because the next step is to get beyond the, oh, wow, and to, in a sense, have I hate to use the word normalisation, but the feeling that you get watching reality TV, flow through into drama. And I do think there are questions about why it doesn't, why in Australia we're very slow to change at this level. But we're not the only place. I mean, I was just working in Singapore for 3 months and watching this sort of terrific early night soapy called Tanglin. And first of all, I discovered that almost nobody but me was watching it. And I was like, this is really great, you know, but a lot of the Singaporeans I dealt with think everything on Singapore television is propaganda, so they don't look at it and they look online at, you know, shows from everywhere else. But when I looked at online commentary, it was clear that the Indian community was having a passionate debate about exactly this question. Like, for once, in Tang Lin, they said the Tamil-speaking character isn't comic and isn't really lower class. This is really good. But did he have to be a multi-millionaire brain surgeon? No? Couldn't we have something... something in the middle. So I think in some societies, these debates are about negotiating social relations, not just image relations, but that are more difficult than people like to admit. But secondly, I have the feeling, and Helen, you can perhaps comment more than me, but that in Australia, the microculture of the corporate world that runs our television is extraordinarily narrow, peculiar, dinosaur-like, and immensely stubborn about recognising its own archaic and unpleasant nature. So, you know, I really think if you cleaned out the management of 7, 9 and 10, we would... They're the people who actually need replacing by different kinds of bodies and minds right now.
Well, Michelle Guthrie did say she was going to clean up some middle management, but I don't think she's cleaned out the wrong people. But certainly I can just expand on that, because if we talk about the public broadcasters, they have very distinct charters. And the charters say, even for the ABC, which for a while has been saying, oh, but, you know, it's SBS for all those coloured people. It has to, it's in the charter that it has to reflect the reality of Australia and have some sense of national identity. Now, we've had Mark Scott for the last 10 years, and when he left, he gave an interview to BuzzFeed, and he said in it, and I'm just dumbfounded, he said, I was in England and I watched the BBC, and wow, it's so diverse, you know, it really reflects, you know, people on the streets of London, hello. Whereas there are a lot of people out there who've been banging on about media diversity, and it has fallen on deaf ears. So if you look at Mark Scott's mea culpa in this interview, he said, I think I employed too many white people who looked like him. He actually said it, and it's true because it's borne out in the figures. As for commercial stations, there are other reasons. You mentioned the one Aboriginal gay character, and I don't think he lasted very long. And I've spoken to people who are who do the casting, and I think one of those soapies had an Indian family for a while. Oh, it didn't relate. It didn't actually relate well to the audience. I had to get rid of the Indian family. They moved out. So there's that sort of thing. But I just want to lead on to when it starts to be taken seriously is when the big end of town says something. So last year, PricewaterhouseCoopers reported that, Wake Up Australia, the media have scarcely any cultural diversity in producers or content. And what they found was 82.7% of the Australian media workforce is monolingual, speaking only English at home. And this is the smoking gun. A lack of diversity is stunting the industry's growth and future. It's the bottom line, everybody. And have you noticed the ads on television where suddenly we have people that look like you and me and you and some of you out there selling products? Have you noticed that?
Yes.
What do you make of that?
I think things are changing. I notice things like the family law, like that they've entered the popular programming.
mainstream.
Yeah, mainstream, yeah. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And that's done terribly well.
Yes.
It?
Yeah, yeah. What do you think, Stephen?
Well, I keep seeing these images flashing up for me, and so I keep thinking about this image and seeing this face kind of turned away from the shore, this idea that, you know, we all kind of live in, you know, Australia is one of the most urbanised countries in the world, and we live in these cities that hug the coast, but we're looking away from it, you know. Sometimes we don't want to see what the rest of the world is doing. And, you know, this still this idea of policing those borders. And so I think, you know, that is still happening on TV. But I still think it's happening in the art world as well. You know, we like to think that the art world is a much more progressive and radical place than it is, but it reproduces the same kind of phenomenon of the world outside. And, yeah, I think, you know, TV has this really, you know, because it's so accessible, it has such an important responsibility. And, you know, I wish that it would, yeah, it would kind of read the SBS charter and read the and, you know, be, you know, represent the, you know, what is it, 1 in 4 Australians born overseas?
Yes.
You know, you know. So, you know, I think there's definitely kind of growth. And, you know, if there's kind of a financial incentive, then, you know, obviously that will happen. But I do think that we all deserve to see ourselves represented in these images. And, you know, and I think if we kind of, you know, respect the right to everyone to have their kind of own cultural differences, and if we respect it in ourselves, then we can respect it in other people as well.
Meaghan, would you like to say something before we maybe go to questions?
Well, just that we are also at a moment, not only where there's an unprecedented multiplication of images and greatly expanded power in people's hands to take them and circulate them, but one where TV is becoming one of the smaller media. I mean, I think enormous change, for good and for bad, is rather being initiated through the internet and through online shows, small films that are made by people. Comedians, I think, at the moment probably have just about more creative impact day to day on our perceptions of how we live both within this nation, within this city and internationally than anybody else. And a lot of that energy comes through creative content created for broadcast digitally. So the world of, you know, the family looking at TV at night is rapidly passing away. I mean, there are figures, yeah, that show that. Nonetheless, like the art world, its symbolic force is still extraordinary. And I do think that the long-term struggle to keep expanding our capacities for self-recognition and other recognition in our own society is one of the most important and exciting things people who work with images can do. And one reason why I'm grateful for having been invited to come to this is it brought me to see the Sunbaker exhibition, and it's enriching of your sense of where you live and who you share life with. So I do recommend those of you who haven't seen the exhibition to do that.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So I think maybe we'll open up to questions. But Anne, would you like to say something? Because your image has been popping up there. I'd love to know. Oh, perfect timing.
Sorry, so, can I just pass the mic as well? Just as we're recording. So,
I'm very interested for you to just say what was behind that.
Thank you. Look, this body of work grew out of a residency that I did at Bondi at the Pavilion, and it was about exploring the sort of mythologies of the beach and looking at those not perhaps represented within those sort of mainstream images and trying to play with some of the stereotypes. It's interesting that my sunbather is often thought, while it's a very androgynous figure, it's often thought to be me, and I had red hair around the time I made that picture, so, and it has been written about as a female, which I kind of don't mind, but I sort of, I guess I want that ambiguity too. And, you know, I really think it's important that, you know, I mean, this was done 29 years ago, and it grew out of a period of heightened nationalism where the bicentennial had happened and so on. And so it was an attempt to sort of redress a lot of those kind of, you know, images that had come to define us and try and, you know, add other voices and, you know, figures to that. So, you know, it's lovely to see a revisioning of those, that image and different responses today. And I think artists do respond to the climate of the time and deliver, you know, and reflect on, you know, what is currently happening. So, I would have liked to actually have the opportunity to perhaps revisit my Dupain, and I found myself returning to a lot of images from the past that I've made to re-look at those sites again. I just have to enjoy everybody else's.
Thank you. So any questions for our guests? We've done such a good job. Yes.
Just a brief question. I'm relatively new to Australia, less than 20 years, and I'm meeting the photography, more in architecture, but profession. But just a question, does totem and ore, does it mean anything to any of you? Totem and ore.
Totem and ore.
Yes. Vivongar. Anyone?
Oh, yes, yes. I know who you mean. Yeah,
okay.
Novelist.
Yeah, he's a novelist, but he also, that's actually a photo book that he created about his Aboriginal life in Australian territories. So I just discovered that book, and it has my, have, you know, coming from the same part of the world. And just
where are you from?
From Serbia. So I just wanted to know if there is any, have anyone heard of it?
Yes. I think probably you might need to be of a certain age to remember, but in the 1980s, maybe early 1990s, a scholar called Sneja Gunjev wrote quite a lot about Biwonga, and if you look online, you'll find that there was quite a lot of discussion of that issue of, you know, the development of an Aboriginal identity by a non-Indigenous person. So, yes. Yep.
Hi. I just wanted to ask about, William brought up the ability of us to share all our personal collections these days, things like Instagram, Facebook. If the Sunbaker appeared on your Instagram feed today, what do you think Max would actually write underneath it, and what would your reaction be?
That's a good question. William, do you want to tackle that one?
It's tricky because is it? I knew Max, and he was very much of his type, like he was old school. We call him sexist today, really. I do remember there's a quote in one of the literature that he was slightly appalled that the Sunbaker appeared in many fashionable gay men's living rooms. it's a question that you can't really answer on behalf of someone, but I think that eventually you pass through being appalled to being eventually flattered by the attention. It's just answering that as a general human trait.
Any ideas, Stephen?
Hashtag blessed or something. it's this kind of moment in time of, you know, summer holidays or something, you're on the coast and everything. And, you know, the leisure time that people have had. And, you know, so it is kind of, you know, a mournful work about, you know, a way of life that kind of didn't exist or couldn't exist. But I do think... there is this idea of kind of the head buried in sand that I still can never kind of not see when I'm thinking about this image. And, you know, that this is a celebration of this kind of glorious, lazy summer day. And, you know, and then we have the image of that Tracy Moffat took of David Gilchrist and, you know, the outrage because he was, you know, there's a Foster's kind of can that he's drinking from. And so, you know, who's able to share in this kind of narrative? And, you know, he's got the kind of zinc-like painted up for ceremony and, you know, he's at this kind of Bondi plate. So it's, you know, there's, you know, a way of life that maybe has disappeared, but there's also this incredible way of life that's happening right now. And if we continue to kind of bury our heads in the sand, then we won't appreciate it.
It's a very good point. I was thinking, you know, hashtag I made it from Christmas Island.
Yeah. No, that's what I was also thinking about, you know, the territories, the islands that we've excised, well, we did, from Australia, because people that we didn't want were arriving on these places, you know. So, you know, it's very easy to kind of imagine who is allowed in these places, but it's also very easy politically to kind of get rid of them.
Yes.
Hi. I'd like to ask each of you what you might think would be the medium and what would be the iconic image of 2017 that might be talked about in time to come.
That was a question that I was going to ask and we ran out of time. I think that's very interesting. I would say maybe looking at where we're at today, and there was one of the artists did have a play on the image of the three-year-old boy.
Sarah Oscar.
Yes, who was washed up on the Turkish shore after he failed to make it to Greece. I would think something like that says a lot about where we've evolved. Not we, where... our powerful decision makers have put our country today, I think, as someone who did come on a boat, but a boat that was allowed to arrive in Australia, you know, many, many years ago. So that would, an image like that would say to me, yeah, that's what we are now. What about the rest, Mr. View?
On television, I've seen this in many programs. There's the beginning of Compass, where you have dissolving faces of many different nationalities making up a community, and I've always just liked that. It always gets me every time I see it, because it is about diversity, and I do want to Australia to be a place where I'm represented. And I think that that's the basis of my liking that kind of representation.
I haven't seen anything that's grabbed me this year yet, Jane. The images that you mentioned, and I think also any image that one could invoke of Manus Island, they're global images. They involve our complicity, but they don't belong to us in the way that I think the history of talk about Sunbaker invites us. When we were asked, or Helen asked earlier, what would one image be, I'm afraid my mind still goes back to the late 1980s and a couple of images from that time which pose a question about the future. One of them is Tracy Moffat's Something More, you know, where there's the Aboriginal woman in a Cheung Sam and then some white people out in the fields, and she's gazing off at something and you don't know what, but it is this extra more thing which will somehow bring these stories together. And there's another image I just adore, but I don't know if anyone in this room will have seen it. It's by a Northern Australian painter, a white guy as far as I know, and it's called Broom Odyssey. And it's a gigantic history painting of the city of Broome, which has like dozens and dozens of little stereotypical figures of all of the different people who have made Broome. And it is ravishingly beautiful to look at, and you could spend your life trying to figure out how it fits together. I think that's, for me, where things are at. The future is a mystery, but hopefully a good one, you know, that one can work towards a good solution.
Well, I was sick a few weeks ago, and I was kind of in a YouTube vacuum. And then I came across this image of this kind of video clip of this singer called Isaiah, and he kind of won, I don't know which one, Australia's X Factor or something. And now he's kind of representing Australia at the Eurovision. And there's just something completely mad about that that I love. You know, this kind of, you know, all of the kind of, boundary rioting or kind of ignoring all these different boundaries, and that, you know, that this young guy could represent, you know, what we now term Australia at Eurovision, I think it's kind of crazy. And, you know, it's kind of a little bit fascistic because it's very gladiatorial, you know, competing and everything. But, you know, there's glitter and champagne and it's kind of fun. And, yeah, so, you know, that's kind of a more optimistic image that we can kind of think about, you know, that, you know, at the same time we're kind of celebrating these kind of ideas of nationhood, we're kind of blurring them at the same time, and there's something kind of promising for me about that.
You'll have to support him for Eurovision. He's got a great voice. He's really, really good. I like that one. I'll go along with this one.
Well, that's optimistic, yeah. Okay, anybody else? Yes?
I was actually just sort of thinking about the curation and like the way, like how is curation changing in the sort of space of looking at contested histories? Do you think there's sort of the role of the curator and engagement with different artists is shifting? That's one of my questions.
I'm not really. I couldn't answer that question because I don't actually wear that hat. Yes.
Well, I mean, I had nothing to do with this exhibition curatorially, but, you know, that never kind of stops a curator from talking. But, you know, I do think that these, you know, that people are seeing an exhibition less as an event, but more of a series of events, that it's about these social relationships that are kind of created and about, you know, not creating something but reflecting something, you know, that's already happened. And I think, you know, curatorial work has become much more professionalized in the last kind of since the 1980s and things like that. You know, maybe just as cutthroat as it always has been. But yeah, there's something about, you know, seeing curatorial practice as a social practice that is kind of emerging. And I think it's a really positive trend. And, you know, that curators don't necessarily see them as that kind of superstar hero curator, but as kind of trying to kind of help artists realise a kind of a collaborative vision for an exhibition. And that, you know, sometimes there's tension, but the tension doesn't have to go away, you know, that we don't have to be scared of that tension.
I think there's a parallel there with, you know, when we're talking about contact makers and managers, you know, you've got to have someone who says, yeah, let's look at this. It's time to look at this, rather than we could have been looking at, I don't know, Hans Heisen or something like that. I think, yeah, you bring those ideas out and bringing all these people together to reimagine. That's what we'd like to see in, you know, the television stations and the filmmakers, where we are looking at different fresh things and also things that are about our country today, which has certainly evolved since Max took that photo.
Yeah, and I think it's a good example of good art history, because it's kind of, you know, it's thinking about an image that's, you know, maybe timely and timeless, but also reimagining it, you know, that we're kind of reevaluating that same image in a different historical moment. And I think, you know, that's what a good work of art can do, that it can speak back and it can speak now and it can speak forward.
Okay, I think we've finished. So I'd just like to say thank you very much to William. Thank you to Meaghan, and thank you to Stephen, and thank you very much for coming. I hope you've enjoyed it, and please go and see the exhibition. It is fantastic. Thank you.